down below, we've got quite a few jobs to do here too. Going to replace the entire electrical system, rebuild some of this cabinetry. It's already been modified. This is kind of a wet location for the electrics there.
For rewiring the 12 volt, we're using marine wire, duplex or simplex. And marine wire just means that it's multi-stranded and copper tinned. And the duplex comes in a jacket, positive and negative. Used to be on boats we would use black for negative 12 volt, but this is called safety wire. It's yellow instead of black for the negative conductor, and that's so that it doesn't get confused with black hot on AC wiring. Aside from the large battery cables, most of the wiring we're going to use on this boat is going to be between sizes number 12 and 18 AWG. So the 12 is the larger, and we use that for higher currents, solar panels, and 12-volt outlets and such. And then 14 and 16 are for general wiring that doesn't have high loads. And number 18 is for low amperage loads like compass light or single LEDs. Here's the basic electrical tools I'm using. I've got the large wire cutters that'll handle battery cable. And these are smaller wire cutters. These are also crimps for the connectors. And they've got a long handle, so they're easy to use. This is a ratcheting crimp connector. And you want to be careful that you get it adjusted right and that you can crimp it all the way down, because it's got a catch right there that won't release unless you can first close it all the way. And it gets adjusted for different tensions on this star wheel here by removing this screw. And then we've got wire strippers, very handy. You can also strip wire with a set of cheap electrical pliers, but that does a much better job. And cable tie cutter. This thing will quickly tension and cut the cable ties. And if you cut the cable tie with the end of a wire cutter, it leaves a very sharp end, which will cut somebody's skin when they reach into a locker. So if you're going to use those, you need to sand with a little sandpaper the cut edge so it's not too sharp. And a voltage tester. You want something that's rated up to 10 amps, and that will handle the common things you're going to do, which are checking continuity or amp flow and voltage. And then the crimp connectors. These are heat shrink connectors here. They come in a kit. It's the most economical, even though they have a few connectors in here that are useless on a boat, like these open forks. But the other I-rings, you can use those. The reds are for number 18 to 22, the thin wire, and the blue for medium size, 14 to 16, and the yellow for 10 to 12. So after you crimp these, you can take your heat gun and heat shrink them on. Otherwise, you can use separate heat shrink tape. And these are spade connectors, female and male. Handy for disconnects. This is going to be the 12 volt switch panel, and we're using circuit breakers. They're standard size. This one's 15 amps. They come in different ratings. And we're repurposing an old switch panel that I had to cut down to make fit. And I made this pattern here for the cutouts for the switches, so we can mark here and then drill and cut those out so that the two switch panels will fit on there. Starting on the electrics, we've got the 12 volt switch panel here, and behind it There we've got the 12 volt negative bus, positive bus, and the terminal strips for all the wiring to go to before they go to the switch panel. And over here we have an inverter disconnect switch and the main battery disconnect switch. It's just one battery bank, so we don't need a multiple bank switch. Here's a view of the wiring before I get too much in and it gets too cluttered looking. So you can see I've got the yellow 12 volt negative wires coming from lights and fans and things to this bus bar. This is going to feed the positive, and here is the positive from the lights and things that are going to these terminal strips, and then they're going to come back to the switch panel after I get the rest installed. And you can see there's the 12 volt outlets wired in, and these terminal strips have jumpers here to connect common circuits. Otherwise they're individually isolated, as opposed to these bus bars, which are all common. And so I've made a sketch of the overall top-down view of the boat, and then I've highlighted where all the accessories, lights, batteries, outlets, where everything's going to go. And then this is a sketch of those wiring points there, and I'll complete that as I add wires so I don't get mixed up, and then can add numbers to the wires later, little number tags. So what I've done is I start by running some wires like these through where the wiring runs have to go, in this case under the locker there, and I leave these cable ties loose to begin with, and then I'll snug them up later just to hold them in place. And they're running underneath the locker there, coming to a light here and an outlet. And in here, on the port side, we've got a plastic enclosure box, and that's for this terminal strip here for lights and fans on that circuit. And then over here will be mast light wires in that box. So I've run the wires out as long as I need them, then cut them off, and then connect them back there. On the starboard side, I've got another box there for starboard lights and fans, such as this fan here, and then lights will go in up there. This is a good inexpensive depth sounder, about $100, called a Hawkeye, and it'll mount here in the cockpit, and it's going to be a backup depth sounder. We're also going to have one for the GPS chart plotter, but this one comes with the transom mount transducer, used for mainly small fishing boats, but we found that it works fine if you epoxy this transducer inside the hull. So we're going to be doing that with both of them. Wherever possible on light fixtures, I put them together with these quick disconnect fittings, and I staggered the wire length so that they can be pushed through that hole together. And that way, with disconnects on them, you can remove them for replacement or testing easily. We've got four mast light wires and a VHF antenna cable to get through the deck and into the junction box terminal strip to disconnect them inside, just below the mast and the medicine locker. So I haven't found any good waterproof connectors that'll handle all the wires and the VHF cable, so I make my own using this 1-inch stainless tubing. So first, from below, I drilled a 7/8 hole, and then on top I drilled a 1-inch hole, so that tubing can sit on that shelf inside of fiberglass and then the wires can go down. This has to go in first, then the other wires can go alongside it and take it out. The other wires come up first, and then you have room to get everything in there, and then I'll just seal it all up with caulking. So first I'm going to epoxy fill that pipe in place. Since it's hard to find the right labels that you'll need, I've got a label maker here, and it comes either with the white background or the black background. And so I've got the black background white print there, and the white background black print there. We're installing this 1100 watt inverter in this locker. It's a KRIEGER 1100 from Amazon for $85. Very cheap, but it's lasted 3 years so far on my boat, so hopefully it'll be okay. It comes with these 12 volt cables, and there's a fuse block there that it came with, and the connections are simple there. There's a green ground wire to connect, safety ground, and the remote cable. So that's going to go up like that. And then on the front end here, besides the USB connectors, it's got these two AC outlets. So we're going to wire a male plug that comes from this outlet up here. And we'll just plug that into the inverter so you don't have to open the locker to get access. And this is a remote power switch for the inverter, which also came with it. So that's kind of amazing value to get all that for $85. At 1100 watts AC output, it'll run medium-sized appliances and also all the power tools, such as angle grinder, drills, chargers. There's the lights and fans circuit, and we're installing these marine beam strip lights. They're $25 each, and they come in three brightness levels. Push this sensor button here once for low, then again for medium, and third time for bright. And they mount with these little clips. I had to drill out the center holes because the screws they supply are too tiny to fit into fiberglass without breaking. But that worked all right here. Got that installed there. So that's kind of an area light. And you also got a reading light there. In some cases, you might need to put a few washers behind the clip and then hold down on the clip with a chisel like that while you press it to snap it in place. These strip lights come with some black wire on them. So to make it a little less conspicuous when I've got to run the wire where I can't hide it, I stripped off some of this white jacket off of a number 18 duplex and threaded it on, and then attached it to the overhead fiberglass with some 5200. And the lights come on dim first with a touch, then up to bright. We've got the four AGM batteries installed. They're Group 31 Duracell 105 amp hour, and they're mounted at a slight angle, so that's one reason to have AGM. You can mount them in any orientation. They don't have any lead acid to spill, and they don't require a battery box to contain any spills. So we've got them held down really well with some timber supports going up to the cockpit footwell there, so there's no chance they could come loose even in a rollover. And I'm making up my own battery cables here using number one AWG. More than enough for the moderate current loads on this small boat. And using these battery lug crimps and this crimping tool I've had on my boat since Hong Kong. That's why it's a little rusty. I think they've got, at some local West Marines, a crimping tool that they let you borrow in the shop, so you can measure on the boat and make them up there. Here's the terminal fuse block and a 175 amp fuse. This has to go on to the battery post that feeds all the power positive. And you size the amp according to your highest load, which in this case will be the inverter. And it should be a bit less than 175. And other boats may have a starter motor. It might draw a bit more. We've got the Victron battery monitor, BMV-700, and it's got the display here to check battery voltage, amps in and out, state of charge, and the rest of it. It operates on a shunt in the negative battery cable. So we're going to put that together in here. I made this sketch of the battery cables and where they connect. So there they are, the positives all linked together and the negatives together, and they're all feeding there through the fuse block. Then at the bottom there is a negative shunt that goes to the Victron battery monitor, and above that is the main disconnect switch, and above that it feeds the inverter. We decided to move the second depth transducer, which is for the Garmin GPS plotter, up into the V-berth locker. It's good to get it forward so that you can get a little warning of shallowing water, and also you want to keep it offset from the keel and far enough below the water line that it's not going to be misreading from waves. I'll show you the circuit for these deck mounted running lights. We've got the green and red on the bow, and the stern light will go on the push pit rail. On the sketch of these terminal strips, the running lights are here with this jumper right there, and the power is fed through the switch here over to here. That terminal strip there has a jumper so that the bow running lights come in here and the stern light comes in there. And up here in the chain locker, this is where that wire comes back from the switch panel, and through jumpers here it feeds the port and the starboard. And the negative from the running lights comes into the negative bus there. This is a combination anchor, tricolor, and strobe light by Marine Beam. It's going to go on the masthead. I'm just testing it out now. And right now it's got power on it. It's got a photo sensor for dusk to dawn operation of the anchor light. And if I simulate darkness by putting my hand over it, and we get that, and then it comes off at sunrise. And then if I interrupt the power and put it back on, it goes to tricolor. And then if you interrupt the power between 5 to 10 seconds and put it back on, it goes to strobe, SOS. I found these other plastic enclosure boxes at Home Depot for under $8. I'm going to cover the backs of the 12-volt outlets where they're exposed in lockers. They might get disturbed. And so you can use a high-speed oscillating multi-tool just to cut the shape out of the backs that you need using this. This works amazingly well on small jobs and in tight corners too. Now we've got the 12-volt wiring mostly finished, starting with the positive bus from the battery switch here. That feeds over here to the positive bus, and these two feed these two switch panels. And these are numbered to correspond to the sketch. So we've got number 1, 2, through 6, 7 through 11, and then there's a spare down there. And those can be traced to this drawing here. And their corresponding numbers feed here to the circuits of each individual light or whatever it is. The negatives all go to this 12-volt bus here. And here's the bilge pump switch, motor charging system, battery monitor, USB outlet, and 12-volt outlet. Here's the shunt for the battery monitor in the 12-volt negative line. And above that is the battery disconnect switch, which feeds here on the output side to the inverter, and that feeds the inverter. And over here is the NEMA 0183 terminal strip for connecting AIS output from the GX2200 to the Garmin plotter. This is typical of how many circuits or switches you'll need for a small cruising sailboat. And starting here, we've got the cabin lights and fans on one, then 12-volt outlets, GPS chart plotter. It's also got a common connection in the back for powering up NEMA devices. And VHF and AIS will share this circuit here. Then the autopilot, depth sounder, and over on this side we've got the anchor and tricolor on one switch, because it's the type that you just switch it within a few seconds to change from one to the other. Otherwise we'd use the 12th spare switch down here for a tricolor and this for the anchor. Then we got the deck running lights, the bow or steaming light, and the deck light, and the compass light. And that's pretty much all you need if you keep simple systems. Of course, you have to add a few other switches in other spots, like we've got the outboard motor alternator switch there. And over here we've got the solar panel switches and inverter. Over here we have the solar charge controller on the right and the inverter remote switch in the center, which turns on the power to those outlets on the left. Behind this panel is the solar charge controller wiring, and the wires come in from the back there from the solar panels, and the positives go through this inline fuse and then to a switch to isolate each solar panel. And then from the switch comes back to this terminal strip, so you can combine the two solar panels together with a jumper, and then the output of that goes to the solar panel input of the charge controller. And then there are battery connections on the other end of the controller going back to the battery. This is the GX2200 VHF and AIS with a built-in GPS antenna, so it's self-contained. It just needs a VHF connector here, power supply, and if you want to connect the NEMA output to a chart plotter, you can connect these wires. Another couple things to mention. I'm using RG8X coax cable for the VHF, and these are solderless connectors. And some people like to run all their cables in a bundle inside of a conduit, which you can do, but here we're just trying to keep the wires accessible, and you can add wires more easily if they're not inside a conduit. And this is the Garmin EchoMap Plus 74CV. It's got Active Captain built into it, so I'll have to get that set up. And otherwise, pretty much done. Aside from connecting the mast light wires and adding the electric tiller pilot, which we'll cover in a later video.